Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome. I'm Senem Bakar. I am the Director of International Student Scholar Services. And thank you so much for being here today. Now, I'm starting only because Jawee wanted me to start. Otherwise, he did everything for this session. So, everybody meet Jawee. He's the senior advisor in my office.
Hi.
And before I turn it to Jawee, I would like to very quickly just go around the room and understand who is in the room. If you don't mind saying your name and which program, which office you are with, I would greatly appreciate it. Maria, I know you.
Yeah. So, I'm in the Career Center. I'm a career advisor. I work with the students in College of Arts and Sciences. I was here just to learn more about working with diverse students.
Thank you.
I'm Selena Ryan. I'm in HR as a trainer, and so I'm hoping to use that lens for this and bring in some cultural new knowledge.
I'm Dario Bernardini. I teach in the School of Communication, and I'm here to just learn more about diversity and things I can use to help.
I'm Johnny Quayton. I teach in the School of International Service, and I notice that my classes have become each year more linguistically, culturally diverse. I'm interested in understanding. What's good about that?
I'm Eric Carlton, PhD student in economics. I teach statistics with SIS. And a lot of the students are
international.
I'm Laura Field, and I'm just joining the FIS faculty. So, but I'm a political theorist and from political science, so I think the student body might be more diverse than I used to.
Welcome. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Nicole Pals. I'm the Social Sciences Librarian at the New Libraries. I'm working with the Department of Anthropology, Economics, Sociology, and Women and Gender Studies. Also SPECS, and I've spent the last 11 years or so working with a lot of international students. So this is like a different kind of positive culture shock. I appreciate that. I've spent the last 11 years with University of Kansas.
Thank you.
My name is Ruth Savor. I'm a PhD student in history, and I'm interested in learning about diversity in the classroom.
My name is Audie. I'm a PhD student in the School of Public Affairs, and obviously interested in talking part of the research on
that. I'm Angela Data. I'm the second language writing specialist, I suppose you'd say, for the college writing program. I'm the required undergraduate writing courses, and this is what I live and do, but I'm always looking for more and wanting to hear more in the discussion.
And Angela is one of the partners in crime and helping international students in
speaking of partners in crime.
I'm Sherry Patillo. I work in Academic Support and Access Center. I'm a counselor there, and my caseload is largely international students.
That's cool. Thank you.
I'm the admin in Northern Directors. I'm starting my master's in international education. This is really my target. So I'm really excited to learn a little bit more about
I'm Courtney Pollock. I'm the advisor for the Department of World Languages and Cultures and the Conference Instructor of French. I'm just happy to understand the crux of the
program.
I'm Bill Harder. I work for CTRL as a technology consultant and trainer. I'm also teaching the government department, and I teach domestic public policy, so it's always an interesting challenge when you get sort of a diverse cultural group to teach U.S. politics.
Thank you so much. We will do proper introductions of the panelists a little later, but let me just tell you that I have been at American University for the last 20 years, and yesterday when Fatih and I were discussing a few things, one thing that we both, mentioned almost simultaneously was that, how much the student body involves with the diversity on this campus. It's wonderful. So I am going to present a few numbers from the international student perspective. Just to start, and then I'll turn it to Jawee. So in general, these are what we are looking at in the United States, right? 40% more international students in education. So about 900,000 right now. I mean, it's amazing. And then 21% of them are Chinese students. I mean, more of them are Chinese students. At the undergraduate level, they increase the students. Top five feeder countries for the United States in general is China, India, South Korea, no surprises, right? Saudi Arabia and Canada. And then the emerging markets are, these are, expected to increase, of course, between 9 and 2020, Colombia, Indonesia, Vietnam, Egypt, Turkey, and South Africa. So moving from there to here, this is no surprise. I don't have to tell you that this is why we come here. You know better than anybody else. But they come here basically, what you do in your classroom, right? So I just wanted to put it out there. And then more and more our students coming to the United States are very much interested in practical experience before they go home. So. Almost 82% of the children are, I should say 90% of them are coming here on funding other than institutional funding. So they contribute around $25 billion to the economy. And the most preferred fields so far are business and management, right? Engineering, again, math and computer sciences, and social sciences. What's increasing, I'll look at the last item over there, is very significant increase in demand for fine arts, applying arts, humanities, health professions, undergraduate. So we are getting on the map for this, right? More and more. Future students, future revenues. This is where the institutions are, scratching their heads even more and more now because the discount rate for domestic students is increasing, right? 40% of the comprehensive and adopted institution as of 2012. On the other hand, and of course everybody is looking for the frontiers where they get other students to balance. Look at the expected increase in international numbers. Especially in English language learners in ESL pathway programs, right? It's amazing what we are looking at. So I didn't have to say a lot about why we are here, obviously we do, but I thought, putting together some statistics might help a little bit in terms of setting the stage. Now, in terms of students coming this fall, in fact, Jawee and I will be welcoming them on Saturday. Look at that number. When I calculated it, I thought it was a mistake. We read it and tripled it, right?
I still want to double check it.
You still want to double check it?
Yeah.
Graduate level, degree seeking students, there are 244, right? Then WCL, all degree seeking, 115, undergraduate, 112. These are not exact numbers, however. It may go up a little bit, go down a little bit. Then short term programs. For our purpose, the same type of service mm-hmm. and everything, 280, almost 300. And then look at the photo. 751 students, new students are arriving on campus, will be in classes on Monday to 25th. So it's and the top countries, leading countries for this entering the class is China, Saudi Arabia, Germany, Japan, France and South Korea. I would say France and Germany most probably, not South Korea so much, are in short-term programs mostly. Unfortunately not a lot of degree seeking students are coming from those countries, right? And then 94 countries are represented. These numbers do not include the Fulbright students who are arriving already, and I was telling Andrea that, I love to see them every day when they come. A lot of bright students on the flight of Fulbright arriving, and I think we are expecting about 25-30 also this semester. At this point, I would like to turn it to Jawee to continue maybe with who we have already as currently enrolled students and take it from there and then introduce the panelists and facilitate the rest of the workshop.
Sure, thank you, Sam.
Sure.
Thank you. What I really would like to do now is introduce our esteemed panelists. Really the goal for today's workshop is to, not to present, but to get a discussion going in the room about the best ways to support our international students and harness the diversity that they're bringing into the classrooms in several ways. But let me first start by introducing our panel. And so starting here from the left, we've got Andrea Brenner. She's a professor and undergraduate advisor in the Department of Sociology. She also teaches in the University College program here at AU. and serves as the honors coordinator for the Department of Sociology. Her research is in the sociology of education, race and politics of identity, diverse family structures, and things of that sort. And so thank you for being here today, and apologize for the handwritten name tag. To her right is Fanta Aw. Fanta is the Assistant Vice President of Campus Life. She's the Hearst Senior Professorial Lecturer in the School of International Service, where she teaches graduate level courses on immigration, internationalization of higher education, and international higher education policy. She's also the president of the NAFSA Association, the Association for International Educators, and has led for years training to the Department of State, for the Institute of International Education, for Andes, and many others. To her right, we have Jessica Waters, who's the Assistant Dean for Undergraduate Education at AU's School of Public Affairs, and also a faculty member in the Department of Justice, Law, and Criminology. Her research is focusing on reproductive rights law, the legal impact of women's medical decisions during pregnancy and childbirth, the reproductive rights of employees working for religiously affiliated employers, and much more. And then to her right, we have Gorky Cruz, who is the director of the Center of World Languages and Cultures. And he comes with us with an MS in Applied Spanish Linguistics from Georgetown, and MA in Hispanic Literatures from Kentucky. So thank you all for joining us today. I would really like to stop talking at this point and pose some questions to our panel. And these are questions that I'd like you all to really sort of think about. I mean, they're very general at first, and hopefully we can sort of get more specific as the session goes on. I've got additional, maybe I'll just run through these really quickly. We can use these slides as they're relevant. The rest of the slides that I've got here are really to use as appendices in the discussion. This is another look at the current composition of the students that are here. And I apologize, the labels are a bit small. But as you can see, we've got China, no surprise, it's a big proportion of undergraduate students, and both undergraduate and graduate students. I'll leave that up. Okay, so the first question really I'd like to put to the panel, and please anyone can jump in, is really a very general one. And the question is, in your experience, what types of knowledge do students need, international students or otherwise diverse students, need to be academically successful in your classes or in general?
Okay, so I'll jump in. So the way I ended up on this panel, because no good deed goes unpunished, right? I recently joined the Dean's Office at SBA and became the Academic Integrity Officer for the school. So I handle all the plagiarism cases and academic integrity cases. And as I was sort of learning that role and figuring out what's going on, I noticed the overrepresentation of international students who were coming with potential academic integrity violations, and I thought, what is going on here? So I contacted these wonderful people and said, I need help, tell me, and they said, why don't you come on the panel? I said, oh no, I need help. But I mean, it's been the start of a really good discussion, and it has made me think about academic integrity in a different way. So one of the, in terms of the more direct answer to your question, one of the things I think we need to be talking about is what academic integrity means in a way that resonates with every student, not just students who were born and went through the education system in the U.S. And it's always interesting when a student comes into your office and there's a potential academic integrity violation because they're nervous, right? And I have to be very tough in that situation. It struck me, I had three cases in a row where I thought, why is the student not reacting appropriately? Why does he or she not look more upset than I'm saying, you may be kicked out of school, you might have met this on your record. And it was a lack of comprehension, not language barrier, but what the cultural norms are around academic integrity. This idea that someone can own words or own ideas was something that I took for granted because I did my schooling in the U.S., but it's a very different norm. So I've had to wrap my head around that. I
international students are much less likely to ask me questions during the process. And I come at this, I'm a formal criminal defense attorney, so I'm always like, you have rights, you have rights in this process. And they're more hesitant to access those rights, and they're more hesitant to ask questions and challenge any part of the process, which means you're more likely to end up with a violation in the record. So I've been concerned about that. And I think there's just a concern, a hesitancy among some groups of students to even ask any questions and challenge authority at all. And when you're in this academic integrity process, that matters a lot. So I'm trying to tailor what I do in that process more. And you know, I think nationally the statistic is, you know, an international student is 9 times more likely than a non-international student to have an academic integrity violation. And that's clearly not because they cheat more, right? I mean, there's something going on there. That I'm trying to sort of wrap my head around and sort of love the good ideas and thoughts.
Well, it's interesting that you brought that open on, and one of the things that kind of attracted me to like the whole overview of the panel was the whole thing about pragmatics and you know, how different things are approached. And granted, I mean, things like the learning culture or what it means to learn and to teach as well, I guess it's so different. You know, I have even like if you look at the literature about international students and how they interact with the American learning environment, they say, well, generally Europeans have, you know, less trouble kind of getting integrated than people from Asia or from Africa. But even then, I mean, I've had conversations with French students where they tell me, well, you know, it's a big shock for me that we're actually expected to have a discussion in class, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, we generally, like, we go to school and, you know, if you don't, you're not there, that's okay, because you only go and you listen to the lecture, and that's basically the length of which you go in order to interact with the instructor. So they're shocked sometimes, like, that they are expected to have, like, this static, kind of, like, back and forth, and that people are actually interested, you know. Generally, they say, well, you know, I'm the only foreigner in the class, and everybody wants to know what I think about, you know. But then you're dealing, you know, beyond, let's say, like French students, for example, with cultures in where it's not good to express a personal opinion, or it's actually even discouraged. It's just not, it's a very negative thing to do. Mm-hmm. So that's one of the things we're dealing with. I mean, and sometimes if you look at what people report as, you know, what the toughest things for them are in terms of like integrating within an American campus, they always bring up that whole issue of language. But as we saw, sometimes it's not a question of whether they can understand the language or not, but it kind of goes a little bit beyond that. It kind of overlaps with the whole, how do you use the language and how to interpret certain things, and then kind of even goes into the culture, right? So if I have an issue with expressing my opinions and someone that asks me to participate in a discussion, that's going to be a big challenge for me. Another thing that I sort of like run into a lot, and my context with this is I do occasionally get overseas students in my Spanish classes, but my big contact comes with in the language center we have a coaching program, and so we offer an opportunity for students who are studying any of the 12 languages that we teach here face to face to come down to the center and sit down and speak with a native speaker of that language. So actually, that's one of the great things about this campus is that we never have any trouble finding native speakers of the 12 languages, right? And so people have the opportunity that I don't think they have in any other campus around here. But anyway, having this sort of like conversations with the students in a professional setting again, you know, where sometimes you find that there's certain cultures where people are just not allowed to say no. It's just very, very, very impolite to just tell somebody, no, I can't do that, or, you know, this is just not being very humble what I can do. So they kind of go, yes, I'll be here, you know, on Wednesday at 5 o'clock, and then Wednesday comes and goes, and the person doesn't show up. So that's another thing, just kind of getting that commitment sometimes, which I see as a very straightforward sort of thing, and, you know, in the style of, like, how we do things in the context of American culture. And so, okay, well, we need to do this. What are the steps? And then we agree, and then we sort of go through that as best as we can, right? I mean, it's not going to happen, then I'm going to reach out to you and tell you that it's not. But sometimes it's, you know, we're dealing with that. Also saying that they don't know, which actually I think all of us have issues with that, but also kind of like being in situations where people just want to say they don't know, like, they kind of don't want to lose face. It becomes quite important. So I think that just beyond sometimes the deficiency or the people have with English, there's other things that we have to kind of keep in mind. Mm-hmm. Because sometimes you have people who are, you know, their English is impeccable, great vocabulary, great structure, but sometimes they look like magic, they're not there, and so there's a big potential for misunderstanding, which sometimes can be weird.
I think I would dovetail what both of you said. I teach where I have most contact with undergraduate students is where I have most contact with international students. I teach a class at AU called U.S. Society in the Department of Sociology. So as you can imagine, many international students come and they think, great, an intro level gen ed class, and I'll learn everything about what it means to be an American. I really start off my class. I've been teaching the same class for almost 12 years now, multiple times a year. I love the course. I've taught it both in the general level and then also in the university college. I have about a third of my class each semester, I find international students, which is pretty large because they usually have about 40 to 45 students in a class. I teach it very differently to international students than I used to, and I think I sort of came in with the here we are to teach you everything there is about our culture. Welcome, stranger. And in fact, what I have done now is made quite a few sort of special tweaks. One of the things I do is we call it the colloquial language or fast talking flag that I sort of give all international students or any English as a second language student in my course the opportunity to raise their hand very quickly, usually do like a little hand wave like that. Seems a little odd in the beginning, but it works, and they do use it throughout the course, which means I have no idea what colloquial language you just used, or I think I've heard that vocabulary word, but in a different way. Could you please explain that, especially student to student? Or, whoa, you're just talking way too fast. I'm fascinated by the conversation, but I'm not able to follow. Takes a couple of weeks to get into this, but once we do, I really find that students in the course, whose English is their first language, do slow down. They love hearing the words that they use so colloquially and understand this doesn't cross all cultures. What does that mean? Because it's the topic of sociology, all of our language is sort of grounded in the ideas of stereotypes. And so one of the ways that I have found I can bring international students into discussion is not only what can our text teach you, what can the discipline of sociology teach you about the way American culture works or U.S. society works, but what are your stereotypes about U.S. society? And show those to us. And I think my U.S. students find that more fascinating than anything, sitting back and having a student from Saudi Arabia who's coming into the United States for the first time saying, here's what I think of the size of your meals. Here is what I think of how students talk to each other, look at each other, what classroom situations are like. So I really love to sort of juxtapose that. I would say my biggest challenge is the writing style. Teaching not only the discipline of sociology and particular types of writing that we do in the social sciences, but also letting the student know that we have very specific guidelines to follow, as the academic discipline does, allowing time for them to go to academic support, to get help. I try really hard every semester to request an international graduate student to be my TA for this particular course, and my department is pretty on board with that. I tell them the reason I need the international graduate student over everyone else. And I think that really lets students come to office hours feel a little more comfortable. So those are just some changes that I've made over the course of a decade or so.
So I'm going to shift you a little bit in the sense that I think the conversation around the knowledge international students may need sometimes is problematic because we start from the premise of a monolithic group. And we all know that they're not monolithic groups. And so I'm going to nuance this a little bit by talking about a couple of points that I think my colleagues have made, who I think very much are in sync with what a lot of us see. The conversation around academic integrity and what is that about, or the conversation around being in the classroom and the ability to know sort of how to write within the kind of style that is expected. I think those are the kinds of things that I think, for those of us in sociology, we kind of call the hidden curriculum, right? So really part of it is really starting from the premise of how do we help those who are not from the dominant culture, however you define dominant culture, because that shifts depending on the context and so forth. How do you then expose them to the knowledge that they need to be able to understand the hidden curriculum? And in this instance, what is the hidden curriculum in a classroom where you're not part of the dominant culture to have come with that knowledge or that social capital for yourself? And I think that's one of the things that we're finding a lot of times for our students becomes a challenge. And that may look very different for a Russian student than it may for a Chinese student, than it may for a Colombian student. And so there's that continuum, I think, of knowledge base that we then find ourselves, particularly for those of us in the classroom, struggling to figure out what does that look like. So part of that, and what I have found a lot of times becomes helpful for me, is starting from that premise that there will be students in any and all of our classes who will need to learn how to navigate the hidden curriculum. The likelihood of that not happening is, I would argue, zero, given where we are within education. So you start from that premise. Then once you've accepted that as a premise, then the next conversation becomes, given that that is part of what's going to happen in the classroom, what does the continuum look like? And then in thinking about the continuum, for example, I think you will find that some of our students, particularly if they're coming from certain parts of the world, we're really actually, it's interesting, we talk about critical thinking in the U.S. as really a sort of the gold standard, and the U.S. being the place that in many ways really values that, and yet Europeans will argue, in the U.S., it's really not the level of critical thinking that, for example, those of us who've been educated in the French system know, right? So you start with that one. So the French student in the classroom probably is thinking, well, for the way I've been trained, particularly with debate, right, I may not have the verbal conversation. It's not okay in a verbal conversation to challenge. But when I'm asked to write, I've actually been trained my entire sort of academic life to be able to give the counter-argument. And whatever my position is, I need to actually be able to frame my reference to the exact counter-argument, and that's the position that I will take in argumentation. That is very different from the Chinese student who's actually been conditioned in a completely different way of what you're rewarded for in terms of learning is your ability to be able to really package it exactly the way you've heard and have been trained to learn. So that's sort of the premise that I start with in terms of how we begin to kind of unpack this idea and how these things start. So that's one of the things. And then that leads to the question of then, so then what's the implication of this for how you value intellectual property? Is there even such a thing as intellectual property? Right? I think those are the kind of conversations that begin to unpack. And then that's where the student really doesn't have the comprehension. Because this time from the premise of there is no such thing as intellectual property. Everything is shareable. That's what it's all about. You know, if it's out in the public domain, it must be something that can be shared. So those are some of the things that I have found in my classes have been helpful to then start the conversation with the students around what are some of the assumptions perhaps that we're coming in with, and how do we deconstruct those assumptions from the beginning is one of the things. The other thing as well that I think has come up a lot of times is that I have found that it's not enough for me to put on the syllabus and writing the syllabus that you will be, you know, you're going to be held to academic integrity standards. We all have the language. I mean, we literally have it from CTRL, and we literally cut and paste it in our syllabus. And I've come to find we have it in there, and it's a way to kind of protect ourselves to say we told them so, and not they violated. Well, it's not that they didn't know. So the issue is not even, and so from that perspective, it's not because it's in the syllabus that they know, right? So we need to go even an extra step further, and I have found that in the classes when I've had students who are coming in from a range of different sort of academic backgrounds, I've had to go that extra step of really explaining what does this really mean, and then even start to give some examples of some of these things as we move forward with that. And so one of the first exercises that I try to do in my class is I ask them to briefly describe for me the kind of academic training they're coming from. And that even really pertains to American students, because also not all educational institutions are the same when it comes to the learning and what the standards may be. And so I start from that assumption and then work my way during the first and second session with at least those conversations to start. And I've learned a lot about how to do that unpacking in ways that even sort of, I think, challenges my own assumption around this notion of sort of hidden curriculum. So that's just a starting point for the conversation.
Thank you. A lot of the things that you guys are talking about really hit the title of this session, which is the linguistic. We've touched on the linguistic challenges. We touched on some of the cultural challenges and some of the hidden assumption challenges. And we can even spend some time talking about challenges that are born of their national, their nationality, their immigration status, and how when it comes to things like academic integrity, international students are often at greater risk, because when academic consequences happen, they're followed very swiftly by immigration consequences. So since we have those as starting points, and those are the challenges that we see, I'm wondering what you all, and please, at this point, everyone can feel free to jump in, have noticed are some myths that are out there about international students, some perceptions that you think aren't true or are maybe harmful to international students. What are some false ideas you've come across?
I think one big one is the equation of language to intellectual ability. Mm-hmm. I mean, that is rampant.
I think that's the biggest one.
And I think when Hansa said monolithic as a danger, I think we do that also with content, where we think Asia.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But boy, you know, not only is a student's language acquisition, but just the way that a student from South Korea versus a student from China verbalizes is just dramatically different.
Mm-hmm. And one of the, you would notice that you guys as a company notice the changes in population.
Yeah.
One of the things I've noticed is even drawing some of those lines in China, or Korea, mm-hmm. or Colombia, I would really get into this, where are they coming from? Did they go to an international school?
Mm-hmm.
I've had many more of my students from East Asia who have gone to schools abroad in
mm-hmm.
English speaking environments before.
Yep.
And that's changed a lot. So, you know, they still face a lot of these struggles, but I find that sort of okay. I can kind of maybe make this generalization.
Mm-hmm.
I back way off of that
mm-hmm.
and try to find out again more about the students from
mm-hmm.
the start,
mm-hmm.
education background.
Can I just piggyback on that point and saying that I think also to touch on the equating sort of language skill with intellectual ability, that we also forget about the other end of the spectrum sometimes, that when you have students that go to English-speaking universities and you forget that they're non-native speakers, and then a lot of times it's very easy to push aside the whole, all of the other sort of things they may be going through because their language is so exceptional. And think of them as a different group, or to lump them in with the U.S. students.
Mm-hmm. One challenge that we've had specifically in our department, then sometimes getting native speakers taking language classes,
mm-hmm.
and that's been a really interesting, you know, situation
mm-hmm.
to navigate, because I can look up the student in beta tell and say, you're from Kuwait.
Elementary
Arabic, but having
conversations
with them, it's interesting because you never see. I get a lot of international students who try to take elementary level language classes. We never have above a 2.5 GPA.
Yep.
They're never first semester freshmen.
Yep.
It's later in their career, and they're trying to ostensibly boost their GPA.
Mm-hmm.
But talking to a lot of them, they go to American or
mm-hmm.
English international schools. And specifically with Arabic, they can speak the colloquial absolutely
mm-hmm.
perfectly, but they have never read it, they can't write it, and they don't know the standards. So while I get sometimes calls from academic advisors from other units saying, like, you know, watch out for the Emiratis who are coming to take all the
mm-hmm.
elementary Arabic classes, it's interesting because you can't really lump them all together and say, oh, you're just trying to get an EBA. You know, sometimes you get a lot of students who are actually coming to United States, and here they're having the introspection to kind of reclaim their heritage.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's really interesting fact of the international.
And we call those heritage seekers.
Heritage
mm-hmm.
seekers.
Yeah, I taught a course last semester on national identity. And, 20 students in the class, only 3 of whom had grandparents born in the United States. And I think there's another big group of quasi-foreign students who speak foreign languages at home,
mm-hmm.
whose parents came 20 years ago to the United States,
mm-hmm.
so they were born here, and have continued to live in a quasi-foreign culture here in the United States.
Mm-hmm.
And they have some of the same problems, often linguistic problems, that foreign students have, and one needs to be sensitive, I think, to not only American students have the same kind of cultural
expectations because they are looking at justifying themselves to their parents' expectations from the country of origin that may drive their behavior in ways that, and dealing with this is quite complicated. I mean, then you have, you look at the, even the list up there, there's one group, of course, that is always, I'm going to make a wild and culturally responsible judgment, that is entirely different. Those are Indians. Indians speak wonderful English, almost always, and often dominate the conversation in class because they come out of a culture. We're much more likely to be worried about Asian students who sit, who come from a culture of writing it all down and give the Chinese model that their family was speaking. And then you have the other, you may have the other problem of students who culturally think they are superior to us. I mean, again, these are wild generalizations, but who come with a sense of cultural superiority or written a fellow Americans. And so the most important lesson that I think you all may, and I certainly sense it in the classes that I've taught, is that you can't love them all together. That is, there's no homogeneous or single answer to the foreign student question, because we're dealing with just even that array of different cultures. And there are lots more, of course, because these are the most well-representative of the cultures here. And thinking of ways of dealing with that of diversity in its largest sense, and that leaves aside all the other kinds of diversity which we are promoting in university, but this international diversity goes to first-generation Americans as well as to recent arrivals. And I think keeping that in mind is you, in the classroom, realizing that you have that cohort, which may be invisible in a sense, except that their last names may give you a clue that they come from somewhere.
I would add a third level to that, which conversation actually Klaus and I have been talking about, that I've been having quite a bit in the sociology department. I do quite a bit of activist work with the international adoption population. My son is adopted from South Korea. And I find it fascinating, especially in the classroom situation, to have Chinese, Korean, and Colombia as the top three sending countries in terms of adoption. International students from those countries, Korean American, Chinese American, or Colombian American students, and then adoptees who are American but have that heritage. And that dialogue of what does it mean to be a Korean, what does it mean to be a Colombian, and really have that level of cultural awareness, to me, is absolutely fascinating.
And so, I mean, I think that's a challenge that I think we face, because given the examples that you've all illustrated, I think for a faculty member, the starting point really becomes one of figuring out what is the educational system, right, that the student is from, as a starting point for the conversation of what's in their educational training. Because it's not by just looking at the students that we can assume, and it's not also based on whether they speak fluent English or not. So these are sort of factors that we condition ourselves to think helps us as metrics to figure out where we go, only to find out that a lot of times we have to almost throw out these assumptions, and needs to start really from the most basic. And then the question becomes, once we know where they're coming, what the educational training is, then what do we do about that, right? Where is the line between what is the role of the faculty member in helping that student get to a better place in writing, to the faculty member who says, you know what, I have a semester where I need to get through content, and I need to get my students from here to there, and how much time am I going to spend on X, Y, and Z? That's where I'm finding a lot of times the struggle for faculty, irrespective of where the students are on the continuum. And I think that's one of the key questions that I think often comes up.
Well, I think that your suggestion of, you know, finding out where the student is coming from educationally, though, is one that we can apply to
every student
in
exactly.
class.
That's absolutely
and
right.
I think that's really a beautiful, you know, way to start,
yeah.
because, you know, we all know that
yeah.
just because you're a U.S. student does not mean that you have a very good or a very poor
right.
education.
That sort of brings me to the next question that I wanted to ask, and it's, what are the students bringing our community? I mean, when we start the conversation by looking at some of the challenges in terms of, you know, being in a culturally unfamiliar environment or being, you know, facing some of the linguistic challenges, and when we look at some of the support services that we provide, we are tempted to think, just from that very superficial look, that what they're bringing us in all their different ways is you know, an experience with U.S. academic culture and imperfect English and all these sort of deficiencies. And I'm wondering what, you know, since all of you are articulating all the different things, all the different sides of the students that you're seeing, what do they bring us? What are we seeing, and how does that enrich the learning environment for all of us?
I think I can get a little rolling on that, because we basically benefit tremendously from having all these speakers of foreign languages,
mm-hmm.
Because of the fact that they speak foreign languages, and we can give the opportunity to our students to partner up with somebody and get the oral practice that sometimes is impractical to have in the classroom, just because, you know, you have 15 kids, and, you know, sometimes it's more than that, mm-hmm. and you have 45 minutes to do a language course. Yes, you can probably go through all the concepts and the grammar in a couple of days, but it would be very little time to kind of practice in individual groups, you know, so they don't get as much as they should. So definitely that's something that's put in. I think it's also really interesting to see, you know, because we have at least in the context of the language center, because we have all these people coming together from these different extractions and seeing how they band together, right? So another one of the things that you made me think about with comments is there's all these other dimensions about how people decide to integrate when they come into an external environment, an international environment, you know, so that you have like a social border ties, we're gonna go and basically open up to try whatever and just say hi to everybody, and you know, there's gonna make a lot of contacts. So people who are a little bit more collectivistic, they want to kind of like, they find all the other Chinese students on campus, you know, and they kind of like band together. You know, and there are people who are just, they see themselves as self-reliant, and they kind of like go through and they try to figure it out on their own. Right? So we get all these different kind of people, and it's really interesting to see sometimes how they, along a few semesters, kind of change and move from one group to another, or they become like really good friends with, you know, somebody that you wouldn't expect them to, you know, like I have like, you know, Chinese students that become really good friends with Colombians, and somehow they find these commonalities, you know, which is something that I think it's great for the campus, but it's also like when they go, they're like something that they're going to take with about, you know, what it means to interact with others and how much more we have in common, even though it doesn't look like that much than we have in terms of differences. So I think that that's an important sphere, an important contribution to the campus. I don't know, like, in terms of how that happens and the scale of like how big the campus is and how many people we actually have here, I'm not sure. I know by some of the narratives that, you know, that kids tell me that there's also, again, in the dorms, you know, depending on how unique you are and who you are, people are going to kind of like cluster around you.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's some people who are lonely. There's some people who are feeling very homesick,
mm-hmm.
miss their parents, they miss their town, you know, and sometimes have a hard time kind of sort of devoting time to reaching out. Or it's maybe sometimes it's not in their personality, they're not the kind of person to reach out. They sometimes open up if you reach out to them. So that's another sort of dimension that we have to keep in mind. Yeah.
I mean,
kind of
I think just on a very practical level, I teach law courses, so
mm-hmm.
I teach introduction to law, and I find that a lot of our U.S. students come in with the assumption that our system is the best. Right, it's perfect, and we justice for all, and you know, there's a whole lot to unpack there, it's great to get the different perspective and have international students coming in and saying, wait, you do what? That's crazy, you know, and really just getting my students here from the U.S. to say, oh, wait, there is a different way to do that, and maybe that's better, or maybe that's worse, but it challenges their own assumptions about
mm-hmm.
the legal system, which in my classes ends up being really helpful.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I could. And you know, that's my class. I would assume that same sort of thing is happening in private disciplines.
And I think to piggyback on what Joe said is that I do think that the value that the students bring in, that I think frankly all students bring with this multiple perspective notion to the classroom. And so this idea of whether you're teaching in law or you're teaching in any of our classes, the ability to bring in those multiple perspectives that then allow for greater learning for all. And I think on a practical level, where I find that I have to use some different techniques, because again, of the students coming from all different spectrum of lived experiences, it's been also to now value more the use of technology. I was one of those faculty who was really skeptical about the medium of technology as a medium for learning, and I've had to actually come to understand and actually see the value of it, particularly for those students who may not be as quick to raise their hand, who may not be as quick to speak up, and so forth. So I now build into my courses an opportunity for reflection. And that reflection is done, not my favorite platform right now, but it's done via Blackboard. and what that helps me do is then to go and read it and come up with some critical questions that then help the students have ownership of their learning, and then allow, for example, for the student who's quiet, that could be an international student who's quiet, it could be friendly an American student, it could be any student, then I'm able to help empower them to feel like they have a contribution that they can bring to the classroom, has been one of those techniques that I have found to be helpful to get the multiple perspective out in a way as well.
Can I just piggyback on that for a second? I had an experience where I taught in person and online, and I had international students in both courses, and I was amazed at the different level of participation at seemingly a higher level in the online course, because it was time to sit and write and think, and it wasn't that, you know, it was a student who said barely anything in the in-person class, but on the chat boards, on Blackboard, was the most vocal, and it was fascinating.
And Jawee asked about myths or that come up, that's one.
Yeah.
You find students not engaged.
Yeah.
Right. And then in terms of advantages,
yeah.
What you're saying, I have to keep rethinking my teaching.
Yes.
Right.
All the time. And so maybe that's a little bit selfish perspective. I like selfish perspective a lot. But for me, always have to like, okay, what is it, language, I need to have more visual stuff? Do I need to give more time to respond so that they can get into the conversation too? Kind of get those other perspectives. And just give me way honest in my teaching.
And what I like about what you all are saying is that you're talking about changes to the learning environment that don't remediate the challenges of international students, but actually enhance the learning for all students. Right? I mean, we're talking about, Andrea, you started off by talking about your classes in which there were a lot of unconscious assumptions people had about the cultural knowledge that came out of their mouth when they spoke. And in my experience, I've seen lots of just examples from language. People are using idiomatic expressions that they don't realize they're using, where when you look at the individual words, of course, the student knows those words, but they don't know what you're saying when you talk about the David and Goliath situation in the Middle East, or when you say, you know, this issue is cut and dry, you know, don't be afraid to go out on a limb. And students are thinking, I know those words, but but I mean, until you have somebody ask, you know, examining, you know, the unconscious language you're using, it never goes. Examine.
To make that even more concrete, yeah. I usually in the first week of this particular class, I teach US society, I do something on language and culture, and I have in my, I show a cartoon or comic strip using the word dude to the class, and it's fascinating to me to watch students who are American speakers or English speakers who make the assumption, of course, that everybody knows the word dude, and of course you use the word dude with different connotation, or different volume, or different tenor of your voice, it's going to mean something different. And then when we open it up, and we ask international students, do you have a word like that in your culture? That sort of means everything, and that young people can use it, and you use it, and they do. And they give us those words, whatever they might be, and it's just fascinating for me to watch my U.S. students go, man, that's not just a U.S. thing. Every culture has this in teenagehood, and what does it mean? One more thing I just wanted to say, and a lot of these comments make me think about it, and that I think I've been guilty of, is not realizing all the time or not bringing to the forefront of my mind that international students also have multiple identities. Mm-hmm. So they might be struggling with LGBT issues, they might be an athlete, they might be a student with a learning disability, and it's not only the fact that English is their second language or that they might be in culture shock that is the first and foremost.
One of the things that you guys made me think about was, again, even being in a language classroom, you're teaching somebody a foreign language. So from the other perspective, you know, like one of the most difficult things that people find is, even when you have the opportunity to speak, people are very reticent to do that. They're so, sometimes they have a great level, but they're just like, so scared. You're placing yourself in a very vulnerable position by doing this, you know, it might not come out right. And so we spent a couple of sessions with me in the semester, they say, you know, we started this time and we closed down the door and whatever. This is like Vegas, you know, whatever happens here stays. So it takes a little while, but eventually everybody feels comfortable enough that they can actually participate in a meaningful way. So I guess, like, what I'm reading a couple of articles about, you know, the perspectives of international students, and I actually, this whole verbal thing is a big deal, because a lot of them, even though they have really great levels of competency in English, they just feel very self-conscious about, you know, their verbal abilities, and so sometimes kind of offering those multiple avenues for them to participate is a very important thing. And then kind of going on your comment about having grad student, international grad student helping you out, I think that's something that maybe we need a little bit more of, and sometimes it's not that practical. I tried that out in my classes and I was very surprised, because some of these, like, they just get so excited. I mean, I see excitement on both sides from their grads, from their student, well, this wasn't a grad student, it was one of the coaches. And I sort of embedded in one of the classes to come and I do kind of like jump around, so I'm working with who is working, or she might be working with another one. And so it's really interesting, you know, because students are like, well, that's, where are you from? You know, what kind of Spanish do you speak? I think that if you can somehow encourage more of that friction between, you know, international students and US students, that would be a worthwhile thing to pursue. And so, you know.
And that leads another question for me to the audience. I mean, how many of you in your classes tend to use a lot of small group of team kind of assignments, or out of curiosity? How do you negotiate those around some of the linguistic power relations and all of that stuff?
I mean, I'll try to, you know, usually I'll end up deciding the makeup of the groups rather than just let them, because then they'll leave those folks out, right? So I'll try to pair them up with someone I think is going to be a good match.
Yeah, I do
it
entirely arbitrarily. I'm going to have groups of four, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2. Mm-hmm. Or I do it, and then the next time we'll be groups of six, and so they get mixed up with different people, but they never put together one of the challenges I mentioned in the panels, we put a lot of emphasis in throughout our educational system at the university level on communication skills. That is, we expect our students to come out with better communication skills than they came in. And we think of those in two different ways. And one is oral skills. So most classes have a presentation. And my experience is that foreign students actually do quite well in presentations, partly because we don't criticize their language, and they see that some of the native speakers do terrible presentations, boring, don't keep it a time. So they're not nearly as threatened as you might think. And then there's the written problem, where we have a certain expectation of fluency and quality, where foreign students may have really big problems, which are very hard to overcome in terms of syntax and structures. Can't generalize again across this whole universe of foreign students, but some languages are harder to learn English from. And the question I like to sort of experience with panel is, how do you maintain quality standards in writing? How much do you in fact have a double standard? There is foreign English and there is American English, and we close our eyes at the quality of the foreign student's work, not conceptually, but linguistically, and shouldn't.
The director of the writing program was something we grade every single student in the class differently. He faced that all the time, and he said even have a U.S. student come into this system who struggles a lot with literacy skills, perhaps, but generation 1.5 or even not, and then students who don't. So one of the things that John Herman would say is that we are treating everybody differently. I think one of the ways that I'll handle it, I'm teaching a writing course, so that's the one thing. But when I'm working with professors around, like, what are those goals? What is this assignment? What does this paper need to show you? Is the emphasis on the concept? is it something that this is a graduate paper and we need to be able to work with this with publishable quality? So what does that entail doing? And I would work with a student on that. And if you're, I'd work with professor say, okay, if you want every A and the and preparation correct, then you may need to counsel your student about how to get a friend to help them work those out. But then I, as a professor, do I need every A and the correct in the paper? So I think those are some of the balances that I will do. My students always come out of my class better. But like, what do they really need to show me in here in terms of the literacy skills? What is the goal of this paper to be? And those are some of the factors.
So my classes, I learned the hard way, but I didn't learn.
Mm-hmm.
I have rubrics for grading for every single assignment. That's my syllabus is about 27 pages. But there's a reason why I realized that I needed to get to that, because it really goes back to really the thing that you're making sense, which is I found I teach primarily at the graduate level. Out of a class of 721 students, I'm really lucky if I have two really good writers in the class. I mean, at the graduate level, writing is really, really cool.
Mm-hmm.
And my students hear from this, hear about this acknowledgement. And it's been a battle because I've been trying to figure out, okay, we have a semester, we have so many things we need to get through. How much am I vested in really getting them from A to what I think they can get to? Understanding that, again, there's that whole continuum, right? So the first thing I decided to do was really for each assignment, the rubric. How much of it is really based on concept? How much of it is based on grammar? All these different things. And they think visually, they know how many points and things will be inducted into those different pieces. So that at least there's transparency for everyone to take around that. That's been one of the things. And it has helped me a lot in then being able to sit down with students and say, well, here's why you got the grade you did on XYZ. The other thing that I've had to do is that I have finally come to the resolve that it really is important for students and all our students to learn to be better writers. So I have also come to the point where I will give them rewrites.
Mm-hmm.
Where I've said to students, you know what? For those who did really well, you've done really well. My point in this class is really for you to learn. So if that's the point that I need to get you to, then in some cases we will have rewrite, and then I'll have sort of what I call really sort of the average of that grade. Because then what I have found is students who then decide to go through that, by the time we start to the time we end, they are writing a bit better. So there is that progression, and it has to do again with the fundamental need for training. And the fact that they have not been really, frankly, trained as much as we would like to see them train.
One of the interesting things about the way the world is today, I guess, is that we also get a lot of people who are heritage speakers. And I had a very interesting case where I had like a student who was a native. English, so she's born and raised here, Puerto Rican extraction, so she was a heritage speaker of Spanish. But then her mother had worked for a while in Brazil, so they went to Brazil and she learned Portuguese. She was quite conversational, quite good at Portuguese, and then she's taking Spanish. And the whole thing's trickling down to her Spanish, so all sorts of Portuguese words and Portuguese structures coming in. I speak Portuguese too, so I get so this part like, oh, well, I can see where you're coming from. But then, generally, I guess, it just comes to the importance of treating everybody differently in a way. You have to kind of sort of gauge what was I going to settle for here, to help her to acquire the new material that we were trying to teach her. So this was like a grammar course, basically, a third-year grammar course. You're supposed to be kind of like refining your Spanish. Right, so I had that case, and then I had somebody who was purely a heritage speaker, but he couldn't speak, he could speak well under duress, but his writing was all over the place. He was just like painfully shy, and then at some point, like, I had him do a presentation, and he started out, and then he got comfortable, and he just, I would tape all of these, by the way, so that we can go back and sort of do a replay, and say like, okay, here you're keeping your hands in your pockets, you're playing with your hair, you're playing with your chain, don't do that. So we try to kind of like sneak other things in there that they can take with them that are portable, that they can use for other places and for this professional world in a way, right? So he was coming from a completely different place, but he was really trying hard, but he was just kind of like hopeless at some points. So then I said, well, how are we going to do this? Let's get one thing dealt with a piece at a time. The prepositions we're going to be working on eventually. But let's get the accentuation, because he wasn't putting accents on anything, for example. And that's unacceptable in Spanish. You have to have your bad particles in there. So I said, you know, let's make a concentrated effort over the next two or three assignments. I want to see you try to fill your accents as best you can. Look them up in the dictionary, run a grammar check or something to sort of get them in there. Eventually, he got past that. And I said, well, it's not a complex thing to do, but I appreciate that it is going to be a little bit of a challenge for you. But once we move beyond that, then you can start working. We work a little bit on the preposition. So we kind of did it in stages, while at the same time trying to deal with, you know, you're responsible for the cultural content and the other things that we're doing in the class, right? So I think what you're saying, and sometimes the whole idea with the feedback is, you know, how much feedback can they take? And you know, sometimes you have to kind of pick the most salient problem, try to deal with that as best you can, get that under your belt, and then kind of move on to the next thing. Sometimes less is more, right?
I have a question about, and you addressed this maybe a little bit earlier about the cultural differences. And I think there's a certain reluctance on the part of some students to ask for help, even if they certainly get certainly wanted. And for example, I had one student who was from Peru, and you know, she was always engaged in class, paying attention, but on the exam, she didn't do very well. And so I talked about her after one of the exams, and here she was saying she didn't understand some of the questions on the exam, because some of the questions, again, are usually popular, and she said, I have no idea what that means. And I said, well, you know, come up and ask me, don't worry about it. You know, don't be embarrassed. Come up and ask for help. She said, well, my father told me not to get help from anyone. I have to go on my own. So I said, well, you know what? I won't tell your father if you don't tell me. It's okay. Right? You're going to be fine. And, you know, and she ended up getting an A, of course, because, you know, she was working way past the young students in the class. But how do you deal with, you know, that sort of?
I actually now, at the top of a pop quiz or a test, I actually type on every single one. If, you know, I can't even remember the way to word it, but, you know, if the English or context is confusing to you, please raise your hand and I'll come to you. So right off the bat, it kind of says, you may know the material, but I'm asking a question and it's a little bit awkward for you. Let me clarify for you. I'm not getting the answer, but let me clarify the question. And I found over the years that I now actually put that on the top of the paper.
You can also see that with office hours. So I think that we can sometimes have effective numbers assumptions that if a student cares and wants to do better, he or she will come to office hours. And that there are barriers for lots of different types of students, you know, around that. So I actually have some colleagues who have now started instituting mandatory office hours. So everyone has to come. It's not a choice, it's not a, you know, you have to come in the first 2 weeks of the semester. And so then you start that initial conversation. They see that it is something that you want to happen, right? They're not intruding on your time, they're not, you know, you are actually there in your office for office hours for a reason, right? But making it mandatory in that way and setting the norm,
that was what was really helpful.
Thank you.
And the other thing is, in addition to sort of the mandatory piece, sometimes because the class size can be very large and so forth, one of the things I try to do is very early into the semester have at least a short assignment for me to gauge where my students are at. And what I end up doing is, for the students that I feel already are struggling, what I do is I hold their papers and I ask them to come and see me. So that becomes the entry point for the discussion about what's happening, let's first look at this paper, go through it and everything. Then we get into some other conversations around the training and things, expectations around those pieces to kind of open the door for how I would have some expectations around office hours and really showing up and how we can work together to make that happen. And I have found that that's been also another really effective way to get some of those students in the space so we can have that conversation.
And that captures other groups of students, too, right? And the academic support. And, you know, and so I love that. It levels the playing field that
And sometimes it's just important to have that conversation, I mean, not only with international students, but with everybody. Mm-hmm. At the very beginning of the semester, like, just kind of like the conversation, this is a safe area for us to learn, and if you knew Spanish or French or feeling your subject here, you would be here. right? If you spoke Spanish perfectly, you would need to be here. So along those same lines, it's like, this is what's available. You know, and I encourage you to come to office hours and to ask questions. And if something is unclear or you can find it, don't wait until 5 minutes before the time is due to write me. Or don't write at 3 o'clock in the morning, you know. If you write Senor Cruz at 3 o'clock in the morning, he's hugging his pillow. He's not going to answer you until 9 a.m. the next day. You know, and after 5 p.m., Senor Cruz might not answer your email because he's out walking his dog or taking his kids to soccer practice or his daughter to ballet or whatever. So, you know, don't expect, you know, that. So sometimes also just giving that expectations about what you're willing to do. You know, so they can write me over the weekend, but they cannot write me overnight because I might not see that. So that also helps them sort of gauge and approach you directly in class, you know, just let you know if they're having any issues. So I think that just like laying that out and then giving them little reminders throughout the semester when people are faltering, just like do a general sort of like, you know, I'm here, you need to complete these hours. Or these are the resources, remember that you're gonna, you know, you can access this or this or this if you have issues. That so brings it out too.
It brings up an interesting issue on where the sort of locus of supporting students academically can be, where it should be, because I really sympathize with faculty who say that, who expressed the challenge that you expressed and said, you know, how much time do I really have to get them to write effectively? I mean, I'm teaching politics here, they need to be able to write effectively, do well in my class, and how much can I get them from here to there? And knowing that there are academic support services here on campus, how much can I do? How much can they do? And it's, you know, I feel like sometimes I have strong opinions on this topic because I so often hear from people who have a sort of remedial approach and want to, you know, do that. But on the other hand, it's a valid question. I mean, when, you know, how exactly, how much can you do in the classroom? And what is your role as a, you know, as a professor of that class in supporting the student?
And there's the added challenge when the student is in a new academic area and they're learning a whole new vocabulary. I mean, I've spoken to colleagues in anthropology and they have the same issues we have. Mm-hmm. So every student is learning this brand new vocabulary, mm-hmm. or a hidden curriculum, what it means, how to write about it, but they've got that language barrier as well.
I have a sort of one general question about the international program overall, and it sounds like that it's going great, and it sounds like there's really good prospects for the future, but I was wondering if you find that there's a challenge in getting international students. I mean, it doesn't seem to be from what you were saying, but, and the reason I'm asking the question is that just because, you know, there's been a lot of negative publicity in the media about the U.S. immigration policy over the past few years, et cetera, all that, and then I had, at my previous school, I taught a grad course, and of 20 students, I had 7 or 8 that were international, and they were from all over, so I had France, Italy, Peru, China, India, and part of the class involved them looking at case studies. It was a communication course, so looking at case studies and looking at how somebody did something. So one of the courses involved healthcare. And this student was from Canada, and she said she was just amazed looking at the situation because they were talking about, right, the profit motive, and they were talking about the health insurance companies, and she said, crazy, I mean, I couldn't believe some of the stuff I was reading. And then another one involved coverage of mass shootings. Mm-hmm. Okay, so then we got into the whole discussion about gun control, et cetera. So, I mean, do you find students questioning that and concerns from students coming in? Apparently not.
To the extent that
rethink
coming
about
to the U.S.?
Well, not just American, I mean, rethinking coming to the U.S.
Right.
I think one of the biggest concerns has to do with safety.
Yeah.
I think certainly, particularly shootings that are happening at universities, in addition to just the whole gun control.
Right.
Certainly has gotten enough media attention that certainly families and students are quite concerned about that. And along with that, in addition to the safety piece, are really, you know, what does that say about the value orientation of this culture? So I do think that there's certainly those kind of conversations are certainly that are going on, and that has implication for mobility of students in some of these other areas for sure. I think it's certainly one of those that come up.
The other thing that I think also comes up is also the fact that truly, I mean, when you look at the whole sort of landscape of international student mobility, the fact that there's been a shift in where students are coming from really does have implications for at least universities and how they respond. You know, I mean, I think Andrea made the really good point about the fact that, you know, it's not just Greek staff students from Asia, and you know, India is not the same as, as Japan, it's not the same as South Korea and so forth, et cetera. But I just, it was last week that I was having this conversation with a group of folks around the fact that what does it mean in the specific context at this time to have the number of Chinese students that we have, right? Particularly when you look at the geopolitics of U.S.-China relations. These are not things that you can really easily discount for the simple reason that when you look at Japan and you look at South Korea, there's been a history of sort of geopolitical relations between the U.S. and those parts of the world where there's been at least a curiosity and some baseline knowledge about the U.S. China is a very different thing, right? And so as I begin to sort of research this more, I'm also finding that embedded in this particular group of students who are coming, not only are you having younger Chinese students who are coming to the U.S. to study, but also, like any other student, the decisions are being made by their parents, but there's also very distinct qualitative difference with the Chinese student experience. It's this idea of I'm going to come and consume a U.S. education, but without any aspect of U.S. culture. That is a fundamental difference. And you play that in all different ways, in and outside of the classroom, and in terms of the student experience.
So when you say that, without any aspect of U.S. culture, so is there an intent then to get the U.S. education, but then go back to...
I think for the families, it comes down to how do you then increase social mobility opportunities, whether it's in China or elsewhere. And I do think that there's certainly there's a strong perspective, particularly because many of the students come from big cities and big provinces in China. There's really, I think, a weariness about the U.S. and U.S. culture. And also there's really sort of, I mean, you can look at all these different things around the culture pieces of really preserving the authenticity of my culture, right? I mean, I think we all come in with that, irrespective of where we come from, but it's a matter of different degrees. And I think that's one of the other aspects, I think, that comes in. And so as we have these conversations about acculturation, it's going to be a different challenge of acculturation because there's a very different notion of why I'm here.
There's one more variable to that. The great majority of Chinese students are only children.
Exactly. What does that mean? The one child issue. Right? And the fact that the entire family has invested in that one child and is banking on that one child being the possibility for the social mobility. That's a whole nother pressure level that is put on to that really creates a different nuance. And I think the way we need to kind of think about this changing demographic of who's coming and what does that mean.
And again, we're not talking about students from China as a monolithic group, because again, it's this historical time that the one-child policy is now producing the college-age offspring. The number of Chinese undergraduates is increasing, which is interesting because while undergraduates have not as steep a learning curve for things like academic integrity, and they're allowed to make more mistakes, frankly, they do nevertheless have to succeed in a wide variety of different genres and disciplines that a graduate student who's been doing work in their field for a number of years may have the technical language and the background and have made the decision on their own to seek seek education in the United States. So, you know, same culture, but wildly different cultures and reasons for
And then, if I may, when it comes to culture, I think we need to also, look at business culture and social culture. More and more, we see those students being interested in the U.S. business culture. We see it, everywhere in your classes, in our office, in Career Center, you name it. So they may not be necessarily interested in acculturation, but they are very much interested in adapting to the business culture here so that they can take it back. So that's one observation that we have had. And that's not necessarily only China, but many other students coming from very strong national identities or cultural identities. Yeah.
Are there parts of the world that we're trying hard and failing in foreign students to AU?
Africa.
And we're not trying. No one is trying. How about that?
Yeah, no, that,
no one is
trying.
That's
that's
a question.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's not just the U.S., no one is really, it's just not, it's not a part of the world that I think is very much on folks' radar. I think it's only one of the ones.
And if I may say one other thing, Fanta knows, I had a little research, I'm no expert in Africa, but just related to students coming from Africa or funding sources that are available in the African continent. It's amazing how much I have learned, that there is so much interest, especially in the you know, families, in terms of sending their kids outside, because there is no available seats inside the country, but there is the funding, financial, you know, ability to afford that, but the information is not available for them to make the best decision. And then you're absolutely right, nobody's going there, because we still look at it like, oh yeah, there is no interest, there is no money. Mm-hmm. It's just a, amazing. I mean, I still, when I talk about it, gives me this vibe. Mm-hmm. How much more I learn about the continent in general. Mm-hmm. So,
one of the other challenges in my experience is ideological diversity. That is, I think it's all too easy for the foreign students to perceive that there is a kind of political correctness about certain issues, cultural and political. And they may come from very conservative societies, where the, to be honest, the academy is liberal in the vast majority of its members. And they may feel really inhibited about being able to participate, which would somehow be disrespectful, which they may have a very strong view about the respectful relationship with a professor in any case. But I think it's a real challenge for us to make sure that we encourage ideological diversity in our, among our American students, by the way. This is not, but for foreign students, I think it's even more difficult, that they don't feel that there is an atmosphere in which there's a real willingness to listen to unpopular views. They'll keep quiet, by and large. And we want them to participate. That is the whole nature of what we're about, is this engagement of them in the discourse of our particular discipline. Just something I've been struck by. A couple of times parents have come up to me and asked, we're Republicans, will it be all right? and the perception is it won't be all right. And so you have to, and I haven't had this experience with international students, but no doubt there is that at the back of their minds. So what can they safely say in a foreign culture which they are not a part of and not comfortable in? We've got to, I think one of our challenges is to make it possible for them to not be rebuked for the values of their culture as against our own.
Mm-hmm. My name is Faith Spaces. International students to talk for you. It is challenging.
Yes.
Last year I worked a Fulbright program.
Mm-hmm.
And I've worked with them for about almost 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
In a pre-academic program that I worked with last year. And at the end of my classes with them, I happen to go out to dinner with them, and after dinner, we went out for shisha, and that is where the conversation really began, about
mm-hmm.
American politics, American culture, American assumptions about international culture. So this is a group from Colombia, Ecuador, Oman, Indonesia, Central Europe. It was about 8 or 10 people. And it was just a really lively conversation, and I was the oddball American representative. And I'd say oddball because I was born in another country, learned English here to help make sure the accent was completely removed out of me, with the exception of maybe two words.
Mm-hmm.
So I was representing Americans
mm-hmm.
in America in a perspective where I don't always feel American in America. It was
a
great
conversation. And, you know, going back to, you know, the argument about the ideological focus, right? I really just today was looking at the most recent NETI data for American universities. And NETI is the data on student engagement.
Yeah.
It's a national data. Most universities participate in it. And then you happen to be one of the institutions that participate in it. And of course, I'm spending a lot of time with Office of Institutional Research now, what we have in terms of data and all this stuff. And we always like to look at, well, how does AU compare to peer institutions? And peer institutions that would be sort of institutions that our students, when they apply to AU, would apply to as well, that we see as peer institutions. And as we're looking at the data and digesting it for a faculty orientation that we're having next week, one of the top things that was listed there was the fact that about 12% of the respondents indicated that they're very much more on the conservative end, relative to things. So 12% is really very small, right? But then the next thing that they talked about was the fact that they really felt that the classroom was not a safe classroom. That there is a real preponderance here on this campus, as I think in many of our campuses, that if you have a conservative view, that that is not one that is safe to express and certainly appreciated in the classroom, right? So as we're talking about that and thinking about that, as I'm thinking about what I'm going to be talking to faculty and so forth about, it goes back to your piece. And one of the things that I'm finding in one of the graduate courses that I teach, going back to the multiple perspective conversation that we just had, what I'm also getting into with some of the students is having them argue, have a counter-argument. It is incredibly amazing how you can tell the ones who are doing it and cerebrally doing it versus the one who are doing it because of conviction, right? And that becomes another way to bring out that perspective in a safe way, but figure out ways to structurally have that kind of engagement in the classroom.
And it means for us, I think, presenting those arguments
too, you know, and taking it upon ourselves to make arguments we're not comfortable with regularly. Yeah, and that's the key. I think the key thing for us teams to be able to know how to do.
Yeah.
And also, kind of like taking opportunities to have those uncomfortable conversations, which I've had chances to do with them, and it's like really interesting because, you know, also pivot on people's personalities. You know, at some point, we were organizing something for Hebrew, for a Hebrew language program, and I think it was Israel's independence was coming up, and they were going to have somebody expecting from Israel, and, you know, the chat and all that, and so I reached out to one of our Hebrew coaches, and, you know, it took him like a good 10 minutes, but at some point he showed up in my office, you know, was like an open door policy, I'm going to talk to you for a second. And I said, well, you know, I was raised in Israel, I went to the army in Israel, but I'm actually of Arab extraction, so I feel really, you know, strange about participating in this. It's not something that I feel I can celebrate, you know. So I appreciated that he brought it up, but I also appreciated that it wasn't an easy thing for him to do, you know. And also when you have to confront sometimes in a professional environment, you know, when people say that they're going to do something and they don't do it, and you have to call them in and have a conversation, you know, and how do you approach that, and the fact that you sometimes have to give face and have that. So every opportunity is kind of one of those teaching moments that at least to have that experience and to kind of let it, you know, yes, there's like very uncomfortable things that sometimes you have to bring up. And we, I guess in more advanced courses, sometimes that those things are built in there. Like we have conversations about abortion in Spain, for example, for one of the high level courses, you know, gay marriage and all that. And sometimes we see that people are kind of engaging and looking around at all the classmates to see what is this person going to say? We're going to fall into the fold of you, I want to, you know, kind of like put out something different there. And sometimes you have to kind of encourage and actually be the devil's advocate and say, well, you know, I'm going to say that I'm pro abortion or I'm against abortion, and then see how people react and say, you know, we're not going to take you up on it, but we want you to at least be ready with a counter argument and be able to talk about this.
And I think we as faculty members have to be ready to admit our own biases.
Yeah.
I teach reproduction in the law. It doesn't get much more low. I come from a litigation background where I litigated on the pro-choice side. And so, you know, I say that up front. I say, look, you know, you can Google me and you can find what my position is. However, that does not impact how I grade you. And I'm also very particularly in that course, I choose my words very carefully and I tell them why I use certain words. So I use the terms pro-choice and pro-life. And I've had a lot of students say to me, why don't you use the word anti-choice? Or I'm thinking, well, I'm deliberately choosing these words because of this reason. And here's why I'm using it. And what do you think about that? What do you think about that word choice? What will it what's not? So acknowledging our own biases and acknowledging our word choice, I think, is incredibly important on these topics.
Well, we're running out of time, unfortunately. We've got this discussion to go on forever. But we've really touched on some amazing topics here. And what I think has come out of this discussion are ways in which the, you know, the classes that we're in, the learning environments that we're trying to foster are really enhanced ideologically, for all, you know, in terms of ideological diversity, the international piece, the cultural piece, the language piece. I hope you all got out as much as I did from this discussion. And I'm glad I didn't have to use my, in case there's a, you know, slides.
That's the teacher, you always prepared.
I was prepared.
That's a good thing.
But thank you all for joining us, and I'd like to thank our panel for sharing their perspectives on.
And please remember to fill out